From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tamás Zétényi, and first of all, let me introduce my friends. We've got Sabrina Tabby and Scott Moore on the violin, Dávid Tóth on the viola, and Zsolt Balogh is playing piano this afternoon. And we are here to play some late pieces of Franz Liszt to you. This project is was made possible by both Bard College, where we were either fellows or students. Scott and Sabrina are undergraduate students, and Zsolt, David are current, and I'm a former Hungarian visiting fellow at this college. And also the Hungarian consulate and the embassy was a great help. And last but not least, we are very grateful for the Library of Congress, who actually you might know that they have a huge collection of Liszt manuscripts, which is very interesting for this project, because Liszt made some transcription of his piano pieces, which aren't really widely known. And some of these manuscripts of these transcriptions are actually held here in the library. And the string quartet transcription of the Angelus, which we will play first on this afternoon's concert, is actually somewhere outside. You can see it in the intermission, maybe. So I would like to talk a bit about what the late period of Liszt actually means for me or means for us. So in 1847, at the age of 35, Franz Liszt gave up his international concert career. In my opinion, this can be viewed as a middle point in his life. It's a middle point of a gradual shift. Because before this point, the emphasis in his life was mainly on performing. Afterwards, he concentrated more on composition, still giving concerts, though, but private concerts. Before this point, he was an international celebrity, the first rock star, if you please. And there was a phenomenon surrounding him, which Heinrich Heine dubbed as Listomania. And in his late years, according to Venceslavoci, the pioneer of research in this late period, so according to him, in his late years, he was basically forgotten in Budapest. So in his younger years, Liszt was known as the virtuoso. He developed a number of special techniques on the piano, dazzling effects. And in his late years, he was investing these technical achievements more into his compositions. These compositions became harmonically daring, intense chromaticism, tonal ambiguity. And these pieces also have an economy of means, which means they have much fewer notes, so to say, sometimes ending in long monodial passages and silence. So Liszt was once described as a Mephisto disguised as an abbé. And he also wrote that he feels as if he was half gypsy and half Franciscaner. And another remark was that he didn't just write the Dante symphony, he also wrote the Faust symphony. So therefore, I think this whole shift in his life can be basically explained as a gradual shift from the secular to the sacred. This pilgrimage of him actually started after the early death of his father, and Liszt wanted to become a priest at that point, which he actually did become, but much later in his life, after he already gave up his concert career. One other thing I want to talk about is the choice of instruments for this concert. Most of you might know Liszt as a composer for the piano, and we which is of course true. His main instrument was the piano, but this afternoon we will try to present to you those pieces which are actually in a chamber music setting. And most of them will include the cello. And why the cello? In my opinion, or in Liszt's opinion, we will see if this actually works out or not. It is said that, okay, the instrument that's the closest to the human voice is probably the cello. And in the first half of the concert, we will mainly be playing elegies. And so these pieces have this inner sadness and longing. And probably Liszt thought that the cello was the most appropriate instrument to picture that. Now let me say a couple of words about the actual pieces in the first half of the concert. We will begin with a string quartet called Angelus. It is in the series Année de Pèlerinage, the Years of Pilgrimage. It's a three volume set of pieces inspired by Liszt's concert tours. And Liszt wrote to a friend that in early October there was the holiday of the Holy Angels. I wrote 100 or so measures for them and wish I could better express my intimate devotion to these divine messengers. This piece was dedicated to Daniela von Below, Liszt's granddaughter, and it was originally composed for piano, but we will play the string quartet setting. The piece is a very curious first part or first passage. Liszt spoke about it. He said, "You know, they ring Angelus in Italy carelessly. The bells swing irregularly and leave off, and the cadences are thus often broken up." So, one more thing I'd like to say about the piece, that it is written in E major, which is Liszt's religious or transcendental key. And the music pictures an impressionistic landscape, pastoral-like, but not without a sense of trouble, regret, or loss. It ends in a really simple, quiet melody. Afterwards, we'll play you Valley del Bellman, which translates Overman's Valley. It's also from the same series of pieces, and we will be playing a recomposed version for piano trio. This piece dramatically and vividly communicates envy and longing. And there is a caption about the score from Lord Byron's Childe Harold, which I will try to read for you. "Could I embody and unbosom now that which is most within me? Could I rack my thoughts upon expression, and thus through soul, heart, mind, passion, feelings, strong or weak? All that I would have sought and all I seek bear no feel, and yet breathe into one word, and that one word were lightning I would speak, but as it is, I live and die unheard, with the most voiceless thought, sheathing it as I swore." There is another caption, which is from Senecour's Obermann. It's a novel which inspired the actual piece. And it says, "What do I want? Who am I? What do I ask of nature? Oh, why?" is the next question. But that already is in connection with the Forgotten Romance, which will be the next piece we will be playing. It joins some other forgotten pieces Liszt wrote, like the Forgotten Polka and the Forgotten Waltz. They're pieces of retrospection, with titles suggesting that they were already forgotten even before they were ever played in public. This piece is marked Andante Malinconico, which means melancholic. And if my picture of the piece is that a troubled spirit is searching for consolation in the memory of the past, it is like as if Liszt was thinking back on a girl, probably from around Naples, as we can hear from the melody. And in my opinion, this very piece is the first impressionistic composition. Especially the second half of the piece, you'll be able to hear that it's somewhat similar maybe to Courbet's paintings from the 1840s. And I wonder if when Debussy as a young man visited the old Liszt, maybe Liszt played this piece for him and maybe it was an inspiration for Debussy. We don't know. Anyway, I like to think of... so many musicians think of Liszt as a forerunner to many tendencies of the 20th century, and Impressionism is among these tendencies. So the other pieces we would be playing in the first half of the concert is three more elegies. One is called Di Zelle in Nonnenwerth. This was originally a song celebrating a desolate and mysterious island on the Rhine, where a half-ruined Benedictine abbey stands. In this convent did Liszt and his that-time mistress and mother of his children, Countess Maria d'Angoul, spend their summers together. And so therefore, Liszt wrote this song after, or transcribed this song, and let's put it this way, Liszt recomposed this song after they have been separated, so it has a really melancholic tone with long monodical pentatonic pastoral-like passages, and in the end it's depicting the bells of the abbey, not unlike the Angelus. So it's both tender reminiscence and both bitter regret, as Liszt is lamenting on the loss of his love and on the loss of his children, because after they parted he didn't really see his children anymore. So the two other elegies are also for two important women in Liszt's life. Elegy number one is for Marie Mukhanov-Kalergis, and elegy number two is for Lina Raman. And these pieces basically share the same elements. All of them have a kind of a beginning which has an accusing tone, a recitativo, usually for solo cello, which one can almost hear Liszt asking through the cello, "Varum," which translates why did she die? And then usually it's followed by a rising melody with a very nostalgic, introspective mood. And this improvisation-like reminiscence is usually played twice, a semitone part, which is a typical feature of Liszt's compositional style. And afterwards comes usually a haunted part, which is always in A flat major, that is Liszt's key to depict love. You might know his Liebestraum, that's also in A flat major. And the markings are, for example, in one of the elegy it says Dolce Amoroso. So obviously this part is when he's thinking back maybe on the love they shared. And if you can read between the lines, I mean, if you can read between musical lines, you get a much better sense of music literature than the official music history. So, and these sections gradually develop and they go into this outbursting appassionato climax, which is like a painful, tragic moment when it's like the real pain after somebody passed away. And then the music becomes soft again, usually, and the major key rises into high register, and it becomes dolce, it becomes espressivo, and one can actually hear the composer resigning to fate and finding consolation in the idea that maybe it is better for the deceased now in heaven. So let us play this.
Thank you.
were running short on time, so for the second half of the concert, I just say a couple of words and the order of the pieces. So first we will play three pieces, one after another, all of them cello and piano. The titles are Grey Cloud, Schlaflos, Frage und Antwort, which translates to Sleepless Question and Answer, and Unstern, Sinister, Disastro, which I'm not even sure how it could be translated because it's in three different languages, but I guess Dark Stars, Sinister, and Disastrous is the best translation. So these are all pieces of despair, pieces of depression, and harmonically stunning. And afterwards, we'll play a block of five pieces which are somehow related to Richard Wagner. And these pieces will be both solo piano, cello and piano, string quartet and piano, and you might have noticed that there is a harp on the program, and actually the harp will be played by Zsolt on the piano for this afternoon. So, and the five pieces will be first a Wagner aria called O du mein Holder Abendstern, then comes the Black Gondola number 1 and Black Gondola number 2, then a piece called Richard Wagner Venezia, and we will end the concert with Am Grabe Richard Wagners. So basically these two blocks of pieces will be played without a pause, only pause after the blocks.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.